Risk Search Training Session on Attributes for the Evaluation of Surveillance Effectiveness. My name is Vladimir Grobois. I am a researcher in quantitative epidemiology in the Animal and Integrated Risk Management Research Unit of the French Research Institute, the International Cooperation Center in Agronomic Research for Development, also known as CIRAD. My involvement in the RiskSearch project is mainly on the thematic of surveillance effectiveness. Let us start with the definition of surveillance system or component, which will be convenient for the purpose of this lecture. We define a surveillance system or component as an observation system which function is to inform stakeholders and decision makers about epidemiological situations. The information on epidemiological situations produced by surveillance is used to implement adequate prevention and control measures. Effectiveness of surveillance system is thus very important for an efficient control of animal diseases. The present module focuses on effectiveness and how effectiveness can be assessed. More general information on animal health surveillance can be found in the Introduction to Animal Health Surveillance module by Katharina Stark and on the module Introduction to the Evaluation of Animal Health Surveillance by Marisa Peer. Let's go on with some definitions and concepts. There are a number of attributes to characterize surveillance systems, and these attributes have been the purpose of terminologies proposed by CERVAL, a surveillance evaluation framework, OASIS, a surveillance evaluation tool, and ICAS, the International Conference on Animal Health Surveillance. These terminologies are presented in the papers that are listed on this slide. You can find some links to the abstracts of these publications on the web link window below. Within the framework of the RiskSearch project, these various terminologies have been compiled and some attribute categories have been defined. On this figure, you can see the different categories which have been defined within the RiskSearch project. In RiskSearch, we distinguish organizational attributes, which are attributes that policymakers can directly control. Modifications of these attributes incur direct costs, and organizational attributes are extremely important because they influence all the other attributes. A second category of attributes is functional attributes. These functional attributes link organizational attributes to effectiveness attributes. Many of these attributes are difficult to quantify in a standardized way because they are somewhat subjective. However, improvement of surveillance often require their assessment. Value attributes ultimately reflect the societal value and utility of surveillance. They are directly influenced by effectiveness attributes, and they are the subject of another RiskSearch training model, Assessing the Value of Animal Health Surveillance by Barbara Eisler. Effectiveness attributes determine directly value attributes, and they are the focus of the present training module. We are going to focus mostly on the two most important effectiveness attributes, which are sensitivity and specificity. So let us go to these two effectiveness attributes. In order to understand sensitivity and specificity, we produced this figure where you can see the conceptual framework that underlies the evaluation of surveillance effectiveness through sensitivity and specificity. Let us first consider the true epidemiological situation. Some intervention measures considered as appropriate by stakeholders and decision makers are associated to this true epidemiological situation. Such appropriate measures are defined in an intervention strategy or contingency plan. The application of these appropriate intervention measures would result in a certain economic efficiency. However, the true epidemiological situation is unknown. Information on the epidemiological situation is generated by the surveillance system. Surveillance system produce surveillance data that are most of the time imperfect. The analysis and interpretation of this imperfect data results in an assessment of the epidemiological situation, and this assessment is used to make decisions on the intervention measure to implement. The application of these intervention measures results in a certain economic efficiency, which most likely differs from the economic efficiency that would be reached given a perfect knowledge of the true epidemiological situation. The sensitivity and specificity of a surveillance system reflect the discrepancy between the intervention measure that would be implemented given a perfect knowledge of the epidemiological situation and the intervention measures that are actually implemented based on the analysis and interpretation of surveillance data. Assessing sensitivity and specificity according to this conceptual framework implies the analysis of intervention strategies, of the surveillance data generation process, of the surveillance data analysis and interpretation process, and of the process of making decisions on intervention measures based on the analysis and interpretation of surveillance data. The effectiveness attributes, sensitivity and specificity, are two probabilities, and these probabilities reflect the likelihood that surveillance data generation and interpretation processes result in the same decision regarding the implementation of intervention measures as would be made given a perfect knowledge of the epidemiological situation. Sensitivity is the probability of implementing intervention measures when the actual epidemiological situation actually requires it, which means when the epidemiological situation represents a threat. Sensitivity can be assessed at different scales: individual, herd, and population. If we want to define sensitivity in mathematical terms, we have to express the epidemiological situation using a binary variable. This binary variable takes the value S plus when the situation represents a threat and would require intervention. S minus represents an epidemiological situation that does not represent any threat and would not require any intervention. The assessment of the epidemiological situation through surveillance is also expressed using a binary variable. This variable takes the value A plus when the interpretation of surveillance data leads to the conclusion that an intervention should be implemented. The binary variable takes the value A minus when the interpretation of surveillance data leads to the conclusion that no intervention is required. Sensitivity is the probability of A plus given S plus. In other words, the probability of implementing an intervention measure when the true epidemiological situation actually requires it. A related quantity is the probability of a type 2 error. The complement of sensitivity is called the probability of a type 2 error. Type 2 error results from an underestimation of the threat posed by the true epidemiological situation, because they represent the probability of not implementing any intervention measure when the true situation would actually require it. As a result, a type 2 error results in increased risk of failure to control a genuine disease threat. The second important quantity is specificity. Specificity is the probability of not implementing any intervention measures when the actual epidemiological situation actually doesn't require any intervention, which means when the true epidemiological situation does not represent any threat. As for sensitivity, specificity can be assessed at different scales, individual, herd, population. And in mathematical terms, if we take the same notations as for specificity, as for sensitivity, sorry, specificity is the probability of A minus given S minus, which means the probability of not implementing any intervention measures when the true epidemiological situation actually doesn't require any intervention measure. The error related to specificity is called the type 1 error, and the probability of a type 1 error is the complement of specificity. A type 1 error results in an overestimation of the threat posed by the true epidemiological situation. Indeed, a type 1 error consists in implementing intervention measures when the actual epidemiological situation doesn't require any intervention measure. It thus implies that costly intervention measures are unnecessarily activated. Now let's see how we can measure effectiveness. And let's go through the different steps of the procedure for measuring effectiveness in terms of sensitivity and specificity. The first step is to define the relevant scale and state variable. The relevant scale is the scale at which intervention measures are applied, and the relevant state variable is the variable that reflects the epidemiological situation and which value determines the choice of an intervention measure. The second step is to describe the intervention strategy. And the intervention strategy consists in defined sets of value of the relevant state variable which require distinct intervention options. The third step for evaluating effectiveness is to describe the surveillance data generation process. It includes sampling and or reporting process, as well as diagnosing and testing processes. The fourth step is to describe the decision-making rule. This decision-making rule usually implies the definition of statistics computed from surveillance data and which are examined to decide which intervention option to implement. Different sets of possible value of these statistics need to be described, and each of this category of value is associated with the implementation of a distinct intervention option. The final step of the procedure to evaluate effectiveness is to compute effectiveness measurements, sensitivity and specificity. They can usually be computed using probabilistic models, for instance, scenario tree modeling, and or simulation models parameterized with the information collected at the four preceding steps and information on the epidemiology of the focal disease. Depending on the surveillance objectives, the scale at which epidemiological situation will be evaluated can differ, as well as the situations which are examined in order to make a decision about the implementation of intervention measures. If we are considering surveillance system aiming at early detection of an exotic disease in a population, the relevant scale is the population, and we are interested in the situation of at least one case of the disease occurring in the population. If the objective of the surveillance system is to monitor prevalence of an endemic disease in a population, again, the relevant scale is the population, but the situation which represent a threat and which should be detected by surveillance is that prevalence reaches a threshold at which the disease becomes a concern for the population. If we are dealing with a surveillance system which objective is to demonstrate freedom from disease in a population, the scale is still the population, but the situation is that prevalence is above the maximum value accepted for the population to be considered as free from the disease. Finally, if the objective of the surveillance system is to find all the cases of a disease, the relevant scale is the epidemiological unit, which can be individual or herd, and the situation representing a threat is when the epidemiological unit is infected. Let us now consider an example of application of this procedure that I've just exposed to you. The example is that of passive surveillance of highly pathogenic avian influenza in Vietnamese poultry populations. The epidemiological situation is that although the poultry population in Vietnam is partially vaccinated, epidemics sporadically occur, often around the test festival in winter. It is believed that these epidemics are generated because highly pathogenic avian influenza viruses are maintained in duck populations in which the virus generate asymptotic infections, and also because highly pathogenic avian influenza viruses are regularly introduced in northern Vietnam from China. To deal with this threat, a passive surveillance system has been implemented to find cases of highly pathogenic avian influenza in poultry. The table shows you the different information required to compute effectiveness for this surveillance system. Let's start by the surveillance objective. For this surveillance system, the objective is to find all the villages or holdings infected by highly pathogenic avian influenza. The relevant scale is thus a holding or a village. The relevant epidemiological variable is the epidemiological status, infected or uninfected, of a unit, a holding or a village. The intervention strategies can be defined by considering two different situations. The S- situation occurs when a unit is not infected, which means that no infected animals are present in the unit. The S plus situation occurs when the unit is infected, which means that at least one infected animal is present in the unit. When the situation is S minus, the intervention option is to do nothing. When the epidemiological situation is S plus, the intervention option is to cull the unit and implement ring vaccination around the unit. The third step is to define the data generation process. In this surveillance system, a unit should be reported as suspicious whenever mortality rate over 2 days exceeds 5% in that unit, and specific symptoms of avian influenza are observed. When such a suspicion is reported, highly sensitive and specific confirmatory tests are applied to all these units reported as suspicious. Let us now consider the last piece of information needed, which is to define the decision rule applied to implement measures. A minus occurs when no mortality exceeding 5% over 2 days has been reported, or when mortality exceeding 5% over 2 days has been reported, but when confirmatory tests have not detected the virus. A plus occurs when mortality exceeding 5% over 2 days has been reported, and when the confirmatory tests have detected highly pathogenic avian influenza. When A minus occurs, the intervention implemented is to do nothing. When A plus occurs, the intervention option implemented is culling the unit and implanting ring vaccination around the unit. With all this information, we can compute effectiveness measures for this example. And effectiveness is going to be characterized using two probabilities. The first probability is the probability of implementing culling and ring vaccination for a unit which is not infected. This is the probability of a type 1 error or the complement of specificity. The second probability is the probability of not implementing culling and ring vaccination for a unit which is infected. This is the probability of a type 2 error or the complement of sensitivity. In this example, the probability of a type 1 error can be considered as being zero because the confirmatory tests used are extremely specific. In other words, it is very unlikely that a false positive occurs. For the probability of a type 2 error, we have to consider the reporting rate, the characteristics of the tests used to assess the status of suspicious case. And these two information would allow us to compute the probability of a type 2 error. So if we assume that reporting rate is 1, whenever mortality over 2 days exceeds 0.05, the suspicion is reported. Given that the confirmatory tests used are extremely sensitive, whenever an infected unit is reported as suspicious, it can be assumed that it is confirmed as infected with a probability of 1. So, the probability of a type 2 error depends only on the distribution of mortality over 2 days in infected units. It is the probability that the peak mortality over 2 days in an infected unit is lower than 0.05. So, in order to compute the probability of a type 2 error, we need some knowledge about mortality in infected units. According to the information that we got in the literature, we assume that the peak mortality rate over 2 days in an infected unit follows a beta law of parameter alpha equal 2 and beta equal 3. The figure below shows you the density distribution of this probability law. You can see on this figure that the most likely mortality rate over 2 days according to this distribution is around 0.4. The probability of a type 2 error using this distribution is the value of the cumulative distribution of this beta law for the reporting threshold, which equals 0.05. If you look at the figure below, You see the cumulative distribution of mortality rate over 2 days. For instance, if we look at the value of 0.5 on the x-axis and look at the corresponding value on the y-axis, we see that the probability that mortality rate, maximum mortality rate over 2 days does not exceed 0.5 is around 0.6. The probability of a type 2 error according to this cumulative distribution is the cumulative probability for the reporting threshold, which is 0.05. According to this cumulative distribution, this probability equals 0.014, and this is shown here by the green lines. This value of a probability of a type 2 error appears very low. However, investigations of this passive surveillance system suggest that suspicious cases are in reality only reported when mortality over 2 days exceeds 0.3. If we assume that the actual reporting threshold is 0.3, the probability of a type 2 error is then the value of the cumulative distribution of the beta 2, 3 low for a reporting threshold of 0.3. It then equals 0.35, which is a very different figure as the one computed for a reporting threshold of 0.05. In conclusion, for this example, it is clear that the effectiveness of passive surveillance of highly pathogenic avian influenza in Vietnam is extremely sensitive to the mortality reporting threshold and the distribution of mortality rate in infected units. Note that the parameters involved in the computation of effectiveness are likely to differ among case studies. However, a thorough application of the different steps described here will allow identifying them. You can find more information on the methods to assess effectiveness of surveillance system in the two references listed on this slide. You have a link to the PDF of the first reference on the Files window below. And the second reference is presented in the Web Links window also below. Thank you very much for attending this training session.